The last time we saw this Atari 800 XL, it was producing a black screen, but what's running this cartridge? We diagnosed that it was probably the basic ROM, and so today, let's replace that basic ROM and see if it solves our problem. My name is Jespy, this is my tech department. Let's get! Let's begin by building our replacement ROM board. Now, I got these PCBs from channel sponsor PCBWay, and while they do sponsor us, I bought these boards with my own money. And honestly, I'm really happy with the quality that they produced. What exactly does this board do? Well, it converts a 27C64 EEPROM into something the Atari can read. To do this, we need a suitable EEPROM, a 28-pin socket, a few PCB pins, and a single 0805-100 nanofarad capacitor to mount on the board. Oh, and since we're programming EEPROMs, an EEPROM programmer, which I had to buy. So, I've never done that before. It's going to be fun. We'll look at that later. For now, let's build this board. I begin with the PCB pins, and they are there to line up with the original footprint of our basic ROM. I solder these in carefully, making sure they're nice and straight, and then we move on to the next job, which is putting the socket on. Here I find a slight problem. I actually don't have a 28-pin socket, so I have a 32 and cut 4 pins off. It'll be fine. We solder that on to the top of the board, keeping our PCB pins on the bottom, and again, it's all very, very simple. That is until we come to that capacitor, which is very, very, very tiny. To get the capacitor on the board, I find the easiest way is to just tin up the pads and then ever so gently with a pair of tiny tweezers, take our tiny, tiny capacitor. And you can see it just, you know, off to the right of the soldering end there. That's how big that capacitor is. And gently slide it in. And there you go. Nice and easy. That took me 20 minutes. Now it's time to program the EEPROM. So we take our EEPROM and pop it in. Incidentally, this is a 28C64, not a 27C64. And that's because I couldn't get 27C64s. And these are electronically erasable, programmable, read-only memory, or EEPROMs. Next up, we load up our software and then pop in our basic ROM. Now, you can download the basic ROM. I'll put links in the description below for both the project boards and the ROMs, because it would be really great if you can support the guy who made these little boards. With our EEPROM inserted, the first thing we have to do is to tell the EEPROM programmer what kind of chip it is. At the moment, you can see it says select IC and it says W25X80AL. Obviously, this is not the chip we're working with, so we have to click on the icon and then we can select our chip from the menu. Today, we're looking at an AT28C64. Now, while these EEPROMs are brand new, I make sure that they are blank by clicking read, and as you can see, all Fs. And it also shows that the machine is working correctly. From there, we then click Add and select our basic ROM, which then loads up into the software. Unfortunately, you can't see it there, but it works. With the ROM loaded, all we have to do now is click Program, and it should store it straight to our AT28C64. So we click Program, and yeah, that's it. It's done. There you go. Right, let's get the old ROM out of there, and that's fairly simple. Fortunately, everything is socketed on this machine, and I love it for that, I really do. So removing the basic ROM is a matter of gently teasing it out, although for some reason couldn't find my chip lifter, so I had to use a screwdriver. Yeah, I know. But with the ROM out of the way, we can now place in our new stacked ROM, which conveniently still fits underneath the metal shield, which is a bonus, because you wouldn't want to not have that on there, at least if you want some kind of originality. With the ROM in place, you can see it's, yeah, looking pretty good. So it comes down to the moment of truth. The machine is wired up, we flick the switch and, oh, well, that's disappointing. It's the same black screen. Time to investigate further. And I think I have an idea. So, okay, the machine is reassembled to a certain extent, and I have an idea why our basic ROM is not working. Now, with the ROM, with the cartridge working, we can switch it on, power light comes on, there's Atari, and if I hit start, we get sound and the car heads off. Okay? That tells me a few things. It tells me the CPU is fine. It's running. It tells me that probably the RAM is fine as well, because again, it's running. It tells me that the Pokey chip is fine because there are sounds. So what could it be? Well, as it happened, as I was testing things out, I discovered something interesting with this. And I'm going to point down now to this joystick. Now, you can see that this is the remains of a CX40 Atari joystick. I'll get to why that's sitting there in a minute. But you see, when I had the Atari originally, I plugged in a random joystick off a shelf, assuming it would be the same as any other Atari-style joystick. And, well, pole position worked fine. I could stop and go the car, but it wouldn't go left or right. So I figured, it's just a random joystick. I didn't check it. Maybe I should get a proper Atari one. Well, as it happened, I had some old CX40s here that need refurbishment, and this is one of them. But why is it in pieces? Right, so since my joystick is broken, it meant that I could just strip it down to just the bare wires, and let's see what happens. So let's reset that. And I'm going to, first off, use the orange cable, and I'm going to connect that to ground, and you can see what happens. So let's get our car running. Prepared to qualify, all right, work for it. And off we go. You can see it accelerates. Now if I touch the orange cable, the speed comes down. And that's because it's the brake, that's the power, that's the push button, I should say. That's the push button. So again, and I can stop it. That's great. But if I try to use left or right, which is going to stop, let's try left, which is the white cable, and I connect that up. You can see the car doesn't move. I've got the cable connected, and I'll show it here. So, white, black, car doesn't move. Likewise, let's restart that. Likewise, if I connect the, let me see, brown cable with the ground. So, here, there's ground, there's brown. And you can see, off it goes. If I do that, that's making a direct connection. And, yeah. It's not actually turning. So what does that mean for our Atari?
So this is the PIA, or Peripheral Integrated Adapter. Its job, correlate all the different functions that come into the Atari and share them around. And that includes our joystick function, so at least the directional inputs. If you're looking for the trigger functions, they are sent to the GTIA chip, which is why if I pushed the button, the car would stop, but left and right didn't work. So, potentially, we have a fault with the PIA. And what's really interesting, the PIA has one other job as well. To notice whether there's a cartridge in it. And if there's a cartridge in, it tells it to switch off the basic. Let's have a look at the block diagram to explain further. Now, block diagrams are always interesting. When I did my electronics training back in the late 90s, I had to learn plenty of these diagrams. That included things for diagrams for how an AM radio works, an FM radio, and a CRT. All completely and utterly useless in the 21st century, but still, I digress. Our block diagram will explain exactly how the machine works without going into too much detail. So when we put in a cartridge, it sends a signal through to the PIA that a cartridge has been inserted. And from there, it just tells the computer, everything's good, run the program, and move on. However, without a cartridge inserted, the following happens. With no signal received from the cartridge interface, the PIA goes, ah, I know, there is no cartridge inserted, so it triggers the basic enable section. This sends out a signal to the memory management circuitry, which in turn says, ah, there's no cartridge inserted, I'd better run the basic ROM. The basic ROM runs, the computer continues. And that's where we have our issues. Our PIA isn't actually getting that signal from the cartridge. It thinks there's a cartridge inserted when there's not. Result, it's telling the basic ROM, don't run. The memory management circuitry is going, I don't know, everything's fine. And we're left with a black screen because it believes that there is a cartridge inserted. Add to that our controller ports that don't work. And you can see then why we're having issues. So let's replace that chip and see if our replacement solves the problem. So here's our replacement chip. Now it's supposedly a direct replacement for the PIA, both for this machine and a few of the Commodore PETs and a few other bits and pieces as well. The fact that they are still manufactured is great, but let's see if it actually works. In fact, as I screw around trying to fit the PIA chip, maybe it's time for a word from our sponsor, PCBWay. We all know that PCBWay make fantastic PCB boards, starting from just $5, and include things like, well, getting a replacement board for this old ZX Spectrum. What happens if your 3D printer isn't up to the task? Or you're having a little trouble with your CNC machine? Then look no further than PCBWay. In fact, if you can design it, PCBWay can help make it a reality. PCBWay, way more than just PCBs. For more information, check out the link in the description below. Okay, here we go. I'm going to switch it on and let's see what happens. We get a black screen. Look at that. We have a screen and it's ready. Yes, and that tells me two things already. One, our basic ROM actually works. We can check the original, but the version that we created, that works fine. And two, yes, that's what the problem was. It was the PIA chip. Let's double check our original basic ROM though. Right, switched over to our original basic ROM. Will it work or not? Was it faulty? It was never faulty. Look at that. Wonderful. Let's get the machine back together and actually do the diagnostic test, shall we? Okay, so I'm going to hold option down, then put on the power, and we should go straight into diagnostic mode. Yes, look at that. Let's run all the tests. Let's select all the tests and then start. So if you're in the ROMs first, ROM's good. RAM, now I think this takes a while.
And indeed it does. This is sped up 700% and it still takes quite a while to count through all of that RAM. Nonetheless, we now have a very good working machine. There's just a few cosmetic things and bits and pieces that I want to do. But let's hope all these diagnostic tests run through and everything is fine.
One final test, of course. Let's see if we can get the car to steer. So let's start. I'm going to get my brown cable and we're going to go and try and go left. All right, I'll be happy if it goes in any particular one direction. There it goes. Yes, the white. No, white on it. Orange, slow down. Yes, look at that. And the corner, which I've not been able to take since I bought this machine. Oh, look at that. I'm really, really happy.
One thing I was less happy with were a few of the capacitors. They looked ever so slightly bulged, so I took the option to just change them out. The only ones I didn't change were actually the three non-polarized 4.7 microfarad capacitors because I couldn't find them. Simple as that. I couldn't find any of the 4.7 microfarad ones that were non-polarized. And that's fine. I did, however, get the check out the rest of the machine and strip it right back and give it a good clean. Now there is some yellowing on board, but it's not too bad. I can live with it. The machine took its time as well to clean up, and there was a lot of cotton buds being used to get into the real nitty-gritty and the grain of the plastic. The keyboard, well, yeah, I mean it was dusty, but it worked perfectly. Apart from the PIA chip on this machine, everything else is in great condition. It's no surprise though, considering Atari tended to, well, over-engineer their machines.
The original Atari 800 debuted on the market for $1,049, whereas by the time this machine came out, it was more like $199, thereabouts. With the keys all cleaned up and left to dry, I give them a good little dusting over, and then we can reassemble the machine and hopefully we can do some booty shots. The Atari 800 XL is back together and it looks gorgeous. The classic cream and brown colouring sums up the early 80s perfectly, and I'm thrilled to see this old machine back in full working order. Every machine I fix, I learn something new, and this machine was no exception. With everything pointing to a damaged basic ROM, it was a joystick issue that led me to the actual culprit, the peer chip. It was fortunate that I was able to find a drop-in replacement and get the Atari 800 XL back into action fairly quickly. I also got to probe my first EEPROM, and whilst in the end I didn't need it, it's still a new lesson I've learnt. My biggest problem now, of course, is that I want to spend more time with the 800 XL, including finding more games and software to run. Plus, I'd really love to track down an Atari 1010 tape drive as well. It turns out I have a few 800 XL games here in the tech department on cassette, but no way to load them. Maybe we'll revisit this machine in the future then. So there we are. The Atari 800 XL is now back together working. It's been cleaned, preened, and I'm really happy. I'm really looking forward to using this machine more and hopefully tracking down that Atari 1010 tape deck. There are some really interesting games out there for this machine, including one I came across when I bought the machine but didn't pick up, called Scram, where you run a nuclear power plant. I have to look that up. I think that could be, well, interesting for an 8-bit machine. All that's left to say now is thank you so much for watching. Down below you'll find all our social medias and things. And remember, when it comes to old computers like the Atari 800 XL, reconnect, rediscover, reuse, and you never know. You might find something that's a little bit special that's just waiting for you. My name's Jess B. This has been my tech department. Cheers.